let's get started on our colloquium today. Today we have Ricky. Ricky is our latest ASP postdoc here at HAO. Ricky got his PhD this month from Montana State University, so congratulations, Ricky. Prior to that, Ricky got his Bachelor's of Science at University of Minnesota. And before he was in science, Ricky actually had a real job. Ricky was an IT professional for a number of years. Today, Ricky is going to tell us about his PhD research, which, as you can see from the title, is about Rossby numbers for solar-like variability.
Thank you. Right, so actually just yesterday I finished the ultimate milestone, which is approval from the formatting advisor of the department, which is probably the most challenging part of the entire process. So thanks to my collaborators and my advisor, Phil Judge, here at HAO, and Pete Martins, who was at Montana State University but has now moved to Georgia State University. So it all comes down to this. It's an old problem. The noble sun has corruptions. This is a drawing of the sun from Galileo, and he was among the first to observe sunspots through a telescope and really think about what they are, where they are. Are they in orbit around the sun? Are they part of the sun? And not only did this, you know, introduce a new topic, but it really started to change the conception of the heavens, of the cosmos, because at that time there was this idea from Aristotle that the heavens were this perfect realm, unchanging, everything in fixed on spheres, right, the perfect shape, and these celestial spheres, and nothing ever changes. And here from this quote, we see this being challenged, and he says, if the generations and corruptions occurring on the very globe of the sun are so many, so great, and so frequent, while this can reasonably be called the noblest part of the heavens, then what argument remains that can dissuade us from believing that others take place on other globes? So, by induction, if the sun's changing, you know, why not everything else? He was also involved in discovering the satellites around Jupiter, and so, you know, this was a time when concepts were changing. And I dare say that the question of what are the sunspots and where do they come from is the oldest unsolved problem in astrophysics, at least as far as questions that, you know, aren't so philosophical, like, oh, where did everything come from? This is a specific question that I think to this day needs a lot of explaining. And so the sun has a cycle in these sunspots. And that's shown here in this recent reconstruction of historical records all the way back to the time of Galileo. And the cycle is, in recent times, pretty regular. We see a lot of variation in the amplitudes of the cycles by about a factor of two. The duration of the cycle is also variable, from 9 years to about 14 years. And we see these periods of strong minimum, in particular the Maunder minimum, which in this reconstruction doesn't look as deep as it did, for example, in Hoyt and Shatten, but nonetheless, it appears that the solar variability, here shown by the group sunspot count, entered a markedly different mode, a different phase of operation. We now know that this cycle is magnetic. This was discovered by Hale. He observed polarization in metal lines and inferred using the Zeeman effect that these sunspots contain magnetic fields, comparing the solar observations to lab measurements. Now we do line of sight magnetograms that shows the remarkable level of order in the solar cycle. Here we have the two polarities indicated by yellow and blue. We see that across the equator, the polarity switches from one to the other. From one cycle to the next, we have polarity switching in each hemisphere and at the poles, and so that the true cycle is 22 years and not the roughly 11 years that the sunspot record shows us. And the things I'll be talking about in this talk are using other, let's say, dynamo experiments. So we believe that there's an internal MHD dynamo process that's responsible for generating those very organized patterns in magnetic field that appear on the surface. And the general idea is that we can be helped in our theoretical attack by looking at the cycles, or in general, the variability of other stars. So it, just like in a lab experiment, you would be advised against reporting a result on only one experiment. You would probably like to do several experiments with several different conditions in order to see how things change with different properties. And that's been the motivation of the people who started out the long-term stellar observation programs. And so here's the motivation from Olin C. Wilson, who we'll talk more about later. He started a stellar observation program at Mount Wilson Observatory. And he says, a vast amount of observational, he's speaking now about the dynamo theory, a vast amount of observational data and theoretical speculation relating to cyclical solar variation has been accumulated. Nevertheless, it seems very likely that understanding has been severely hampered because the material relates to a single star with a fixed set of parameters such as age, mass, and surface temperature. It is a reasonable supposition that if analogous cycles could be detected on other stars with different values of the fundamental parameters, the results would be of considerable value in sharpening the theoretical attack on the whole problem. And there are similar sentiments here from another pioneer in stellar observations. This is from HAO's Dimitri Mihalis. And this is from the Solar Stellar Spectrograph, which was designed and built here at HAO from their Science Goals and Technical Requirements document. And it's a bit scathing. I didn't know Dr. Mihalis personally, but he's very straight to the point. So I'll just read this here. He says, unfortunately, in spite of intensive efforts by many theoreticians, the theory is at present in an unsatisfactory state. Existing models are only kinematical, and at present we seem far from developing a reliable ab initio dynamical model. The model parameter that appears to give the best fit to observations often seem unreasonable on physical grounds. One worries that we are achieving this agreement by force-fitting an incomplete theory to a single example of a cycle taken out of context of the ensemble of all possible cycles. Furthermore, existing theory has little, if any, predictive value. The empirical discovery of the modern minimum caught solar physicists by surprise. It showed us that the dynamo might not always function regularly, but may be subject to complex and dramatic variations. Clearly, there is much to be learned about stellar dynamos, and clearly, new empirical input to the model process is urgently needed. So I think a lot of his criticisms are still true today. There have been many great advances in dynamical models, but they all suffer from the lack of computational resources, which forces them to run in parameter regimes that are very orders of magnitude removed from actual stars. So what allows us to view cycle-like variability in other stars? Well, it's the longest running method is using the emission in singly ionized calcium. So on the top left, there's a Carrington map of the core of the calcium K line. I don't know exactly the bandpass from the Mount Wilson spectroheliograms, but it's certainly on the order of an angstrom at the core. And you see that this emission is spatially correlated with the line of sight magnetic magnetogram shown below. So measuring magnetic field directly on another star is made difficult by the fact that there's nearly just as much positive polarity on the side that's facing you as negative polarity, and so any polarization signal suffers a large degree of cancellation. The net is small, and so the measurement is very difficult. Whereas in calcium emission, which is from heating processes in the lower chromosphere, magnetic heating processes, there are no cancellation effects, and so the integrated light on the surface of the sun in calcium 2 is a good proxy for surface magnetic flux, and that's proved here in the sun. And here we see a curve that shows the relationship for pixel resolved calcium intensity and magnetic field, magnetic flux on the sun, and you see a good linear relationship. that becomes nonlinear at a certain threshold. So at about 300 Gauss, this thing turns around. And in fact, in calcium images, sunspots, the umbrae, where the fields are the strongest, appear dark. They're dark features. And so from the calcium emission, which is shown in the top panel here, zoomed in very close, the triangle there is one angstrom wide. And this is these are, I think, from NSO Kitt Peak, high-resolution spectra, where the upper spectra is from a region of plage where there is enhanced magnetic field. The lower spectra is from a region of quiet sun. And you see a dramatic difference between the emission and the peak. And this emission is due to the magnetic heating processes. Zoomed out here is a spectra from the solar stellar spectrograph, which shows the bands of the S index. And this has become the standard stellar activity measure. And so it's the ratio of emission in these H and K bands, one angstrom wide triangular bands, with respect to these 20 angstrom wide bands in the pseudo continuum of the wings. And so the reason you want to have a relative measure is because if you're measuring in times of poor C, or even just for the sake of night-to-night stability, you know, it helps to be measuring the flux of these bands where the activity is present with respect to something that's relatively constant. It's the photosphere of the star, right? And so that's only going to change if the effective temperature of the star changes, which is not going to happen in normal main sequence stars. And but this also makes it unsuitable for using to compare one stars of very different effective temperatures, because you know, just thinking about the black body curve, stars that are much cooler are going to have a smaller contribution in this denominator, and hotter stars more so, and so you won't have an apples to apples comparison. And so for this, the R prime HK proxy of magnetic activity was devised. And so that is the flux in absolute physical units this time in the calcium H and K, that in fact only the portion of that flux that is due to chromospheric heating processes. So those gray bands on the side here actually need to be, the flux there needs to be subtracted out. And that's okay, that's with respect to the total bolometric flux of the star sigma T to the fourth. And so this is an energy fraction. So it's, you're comparing the same sort of thing for even if you have a much cooler star or a slightly hotter star than the sun. The tricky bit is in subtracting this photospheric contribution. It's going to add a bit of noise, a bit of uncertainty into the results. And in the first part of this talk, I avoid using this index for that reason. And so observations in calcium through the S index have been done for a long time. And they revealed these patterns of variability. And the surprise is, I suppose, that cycling isn't the only thing that stars do. In fact, it's not even the majority of the behavior of stars. So on the left, we have four classes of stars that are, you know, in this classification scheme of Belyunis 95 deemed as not cycling. So the flat ones just have a small relative variance. And those are the top left two. Then we have the long one, which has a long-term trend in it. And on the bottom left, the VAIR class, which has no statistically significant period in a periodogram analysis of this data. But yet the variance of the data is higher than this 2% threshold for being flat. And then on the right are the cycling classes, which are all given a grade from poor to fair to good to excellent based on the false alarm probability of the peak in the periodogram analysis of these data. So it's just putting the time series into frequency space. You look at a peak, and then you ask the question, what is the probability that a peak of this height would be due to random Gaussian noise of the same variance of this data? That's your false alarm probability. So that gives you the statistical significance test. And the smaller this number is, well, first of all, the least likely that it's a false alarm, but even more so, it's also a rough measure of cycle quality. And you can see that in the excellent class, where the false alarm probability is less than 10^-9%, highly significant, it looks very solar cycle-like. We have this nice smooth variation. In the poor class of cycles, not so much. Not obvious by eye where the cycle is in that time series.
What's the x-axis?
That's the s-index.
The x.
S-index. Oh, sorry, x, time. From 1966 to 1992.
Thanks.
Yeah, so 25-year time series in this study. And so it was also seen that there were secondary cycles. Here's a good example of that, where there are two statistically significant peaks in the periodogram. Here's one at 16.9 years, and another 2.6-year variation that you can see clearly throughout the duration of this time series. Now I'm going to go through... So when I was working on my thesis, I became impressed by, you know, the heritage that this sort of work had at HAO. I kept seeing these names pop up, and now there's not so many people working on this, but in the past it appears to have been quite different. The other thing I realized is that everything went back to George Ellery Hale. So Hale did the first calcium measurements, and so he wrote in 1904. Calcium and hydrogen flocculi. He observed the structure in the spectroheliograms of calcium. He founded the Mount Wilson Solar Observatory, and then started building giant nighttime telescopes on the top of Mount Wilson. And so there's a 60-inch telescope and a 100-inch Hooker telescope that are shown here, 60-inch on the left, 100-inch on the right. Then there was about 50 years of uninteresting galactic observations on Mount Wilson by guys like Edwin Hubble, who discovered things like certain nebulae being outside our galaxy and the universe expanding. When all of that was done, they finally got back to the solar-stellar connection, and Olin Wilson began his monitoring of the calcium H and K in 91 sun-like stars in 1966. There was a paper shortly thereafter with 2 years of observation that showed that, yes, these stars are variable, but of course that's not long enough to really see anything like a cycle. Andy Skumanich at HAO collaborated with Olin Wilson. He found what's now known as the Skumanich law, the breaking law, that is that as stars get older, their rotation period slows down, and so rotation period goes as t to the half. And so that's some work from here. And then after 12 years of observing, Olin Wilson came up with the first in this series of papers, which showed the first evidence of cyclic behavior in stars and of all the other classes of variability. Observations of the sun began at Kitt Peak. There were papers on calcium variation from the sun from White at HAO and Livingston. A Kitt Peak, so there was 6 years of data in 1981. And then Dimitri Mihalis proposes to build the solar stellar spectrograph. He's shown there on the left photograph. There it is in the lab at HAO. I don't even know where HAO was at that time. I know the lab has moved around a bit. Yeah, so there they are building the solar stellar spectrograph. I'm going to show you in a bit what that is, and there on the far right, a fiber is being installed at Lowell Observatory, and that's Lowell Observatory on the bottom. So it was installed at a 42-inch telescope, and the observational survey begins at Lowell. And here's some more. It's Dimitri Mihalis who actually spearheaded this the construction of this thing. And here's his first feeler letter to the director of Lowell Observatory in 1983. He said, "The group of us interested in this project at HAO are Dick Fisher, Ron Gillian, Bob McQueen, and me." And he says, "We want to measure calcium 2 H and K, the infrared triplet, and H-alpha. And of that, I'm only going to be speaking to you about calcium H and K, but this instrument actually has measurements in lots of other lines that no one's ever looked at yet, actually." And so, we looked at whether we could build a spectrograph and build a telescope. It didn't look like we could afford that. And he said, "As you well know, I lack subtlety. And as you can see, if everything goes well, I'm proposing, in effect, to tie up your telescope almost full time. The reason I have the audacity to propose this is that I firmly believe that this is good science, even if it lacks the glamorous glitter of high-profile whiz-bang astrophysics like Hubble and those guys were doing at Mount Wilson. In a very real sense, we're in a position to finally realize the grand scheme laid down 80 years ago by George Ellery Hale. I find that sort of curious sentence, and I've seen other indications that that Hale sort of intended to do stellar variability, but I haven't really found the root of that yet. But anyway, sincerely yours, Dimitri Mihalis. Well, they built the thing. HAO built the thing, installed it, and the observations began in 1992. In the meantime, 95 was when the last really big study of long-term variability happened, the first of its kind, actually. It's a 25-year time series from Ballyunas et al. That's using the Mount Wilson data. Jeff Hall, the director of Lowell, he published 12-year analyses of his data in 2007. And what I'm showing here are, on the left, Ballyunas's observations from Mount Wilson of about 25 years, Hall's observations of about 10 years for this star, and my contribution is asking everybody for the data, intercalibrating it, making composites, and having 50-year time series. And so that's my work. So it actually changes your interpretation of these stars. So this one here, HD30495, was previously classified as some erratic variable, and I found very nice evidence for cycles of the order 12 years, and that's shown by this red curve, which is basically a low-pass filter on the seasonal means of this star. So that's the whole time series. It takes a long time and a lot of effort to keep these observational programs going. And I just came in at the end and asked everybody for data. So first, I'll talk to you about the long-term variability of solar analog stars. These are the data that I'm using. I've already introduced most of them. I just want to mention that the HKP, both the solar stellar spectrograph and the Mount Wilson instrument had upgrades. So it really makes them about four different instruments. There's calibration issues at all of these intersections, most of which were taken care of by those teams, but I found a few nagging issues. In particular, the S-index, I'll tell that story later. So the other is from Sacramento Peak, and these are observations of calcium in the sun, and they started from 1976 until the present, and so those are good measurements to figure out where the sun sits in all of this scheme. And also, I should mention the key feature of the solar stellar spectrograph was that it could observe the sun and the stars through the same instrument. So to observe the sun, it just has a fiber optic sitting outside the telescope dome, and they measure spectra during the daytime. So I looked at their observational databases and determined what are the set of solar analog stars that I want to look at. So what is a solar analog? I wanted to narrow my study to things that are very close to the sun in order to avoid any issues that may come up from, you know, the conditions being too different. So the things that's relatively fixed is the mass of these stars, or the effective temperature is in a very tight range. What's allowed to run free are things like the rotation period, and the metallicity just is what it is for these stars. So with this definition of solar analog that's based on the color index, I get I can construct 50-year time series from these two periods for only 27 stars. That includes the sun. These are the properties of my ensemble. So this is a very, very tight cluster in effective temperature, shown on the left. That's essentially an HR diagram, effective temperature versus luminosity. So the effective temperature in solar units shows that it's the whole ensemble is within 5% of the solar effective temperature. Luminosity is more variable as some of these stars are more evolved. That dashed line estimates where the main sequence lies. Stars that are high above the main sequence are are evolving. They're going through their supply of hydrogen, and that dotted line shows a solar cartoon of a solar evolution track, where it's turning off the main sequence, going horizontal and the subgiant branch, and that's where the core hydrogen is run out. Shell hydrogen burning begins. The star cools, and without changing its luminosity very much, until it eventually there's a helium flash, and then it goes red giant. And so giant stars are not in this sample, and they were avoided in these surveys. However, there are some subgiants. These ones that are above that line of luminosity 2.0, I'm calling subgiants. It's sort of a murky issue where to actually draw the line, what to call a subgiant. So I just said two solar luminosities. And there you see the range in rotation periods. The gray bars are measurements, usually from modulations in the calcium time series, sometimes from precision photometry. But they're basically measurements of rotation period from modulations in time series. So it's modulations due to the surface activity. The red bins, however, do not have that type of measurement. So I estimate a lower limit of rotation using a spectroscopic means of measuring equatorial V sine I. So that's the equatorial velocity times the sine of the inclination angle. Inclination angle is not known, but I can convert this into an equatorial rotation period using the radius estimate that I have essentially from that HR diagram on the left, but it's a lower limit. So those red bins could be anywhere rightward of where they are. So I have good coverage in rotations, better coverage at faster rotations, like from 5 to 15 days, and then it gets sparser as you go outward. Okay, so I'm going to talk quickly about calibration. So one of the surprises in this work, when I asked for the data from the sample from Mount Wilson, is I received this solar time series that's shown on the top. And it had these observations after 1990, which no one has ever analyzed before. This is very important because the S-index is an instrumental flux scale. In order to measure the S-index properly, you have to be measuring with the HKP2 instrument. Everything else is a calibration to that instrumental flux scale, all right? And so previously for the sun, there was no real S-index, right? So when I saw that there were these measurements, this is reflected sunlight off the face of the moon. So you can't point these nighttime telescopes at the sun, you'll break things. But when you look at this time series, the first thing I was struck by was this decrease from minimum to minimum, from the minimum of cycle 21 way back in 1975 to cycle 23 in the late 90s. And so this gave me a hint that maybe, unless there's a real secular change, maybe there's a calibration issue here. And the way the calibration for the sun, to put the sun on the S-index scale, was done before was to use this much better sampled time series from Sac Peak, which is its own instrumental flux scale and its own idiosyncrasies. And as you can see, they don't overlap with the HKP1 measurements, which are only calibrated to the S-index scale in a global ensemble sense anyway. So how do they fix that overlap? They introduce proxies like the sunspot record or F10.7 flux, or they use stellar relationships in order to estimate how to go from just the K line to the S index, which includes the K line and the H line. So all of these proxy mesh could introduce systematic errors, and in fact, I found that they did. So I came up with a new calibration of the Sac Peak data to the S index scale using the period of overlap, right? So now with these new measurements, we've got lots of overlap. It's not as easy as doing a linear regression because there's just not enough points. The uncertainty is in a linear regression were of the order of 100%. But assuming that the cycle shape is the same in both of these time series of calcium, which I think is a pretty safe assumption, then I fit a model of the cycle shape, 5-parameter model, to the Sac Peak data where I have the whole cycle 23. I hold fixed the parameters that depend on the shape, so the skewness of it, the time of the maximum, and so forth. And I let free the parameters that determine the offset and the amplitude as I fit, again, the actual data from the Mount Wilson instrument, these red points here. And that gives me a linear calibration from one set of flux measurements to the other. So the red curve is the cycle model fit. The gray points are the sac peak transformed onto the S-index scale. You can see the overlap shows that they're good agreement. And the dashed curves are the other transformations from the sac peak K emission index measurements to the S-index scale. And you can see that there's a lot of variation. And in particular, they disagree with the observations from the instrument that defines the S-index scale. So I've lowered the mean solar S-index by about 5 to 9%, and I believe this to be a more accurate measurement of the sun as a star on this scale that's used for all the other stars. So for free, I get 100 years of the S-index because Bertello et al. 2016 did the work of calibrating calcium K-line spectrohelograms from the Kodaikanal Observatory in India that go all the way back to the early 1900s. So he calibrated those to the sac peak scale. So then I just have to run it through my transformation. I get it on the S-index scale, and voila, I get 100 years of the sun as a star S-index. And so I can measure the duration, the amplitudes of all of these cycles. I can measure very accurate mean values, and so a much better understanding of the sun as a star. And that's great, because that's what I want to do, is compare other stars to the sun. I also have to calibrate the ensemble. So this is my 27 star ensemble, and for there, I have to calibrate now in order to make composites the Lowell Observatory SSS measurements to the Mount Wilson S-index scale. So they have their own calibration that was done, you know, previous to this, and it used you know, big long mean values between for targets that they had in common. And that worked pretty good. There's some RMS scatter around that. Any of these sort of ensemble calibrations have scatter along the line. So they're imperfect, and that scatter matters. Anyway, what I did is I took coincident measurements, so actually measurements that were taken on the same night for these instruments. So that's when things really ought to be the same, right? And for this whole ensemble, and I get something like 500 measurements. There were three stars that didn't seem to want to fit on any kind of a line. Those are those gray points up there. I didn't exactly figure the reason for their misbehavior out, but it could be due to uncertainty in their fundamental parameters, because the SSS actually measures things in absolute flux units and then converts things using empirical relationships to the S-index scale. And so any uncertainty in the color index or the effective temperature will throw you off of the scale. Anyway, when I do the calibration fit, I get this. The magenta, or sorry, the cyan points are the median values of these coincident measurements. And that's what's known as the calibration anomaly here. And if you're not on the calibration curve, then when you show the composite time series, you're going to see the step function, right? So I need to correct for that. And the only way to do it is brute force. I apply a scaling factor to put everything onto the calibration curve, so I get nice continuous time series. And these are the results. So I'm satisfied with these composites. The red measurements are from the Mount Wilson Observatory. The blue measurements are from Lowell Observatory SSS. And these are all on the same S-index scale. There's my solar measurements. Actually, the black measurements are the sac peak that I transformed, and they happen to agree very nicely with a new calibration that I helped Jeff work on from the SSS. So there you see the blue points lying right on top of the black points for the sun. And this shows the whole range of mean values and amplitudes in my sample. These are all on the same scale. There's no artificial vertical offsets. This star really is that much more active than the sun, and it really does vary by that much more than the sun. And then there's a number of stars that are less variable than the sun and have lower mean activities. An important result of this calibration exercise is that I get nice agreement between the solar twin 18 SCO. This is the seasonal mean time series of the composite that I made, shown in black for 18 SCO, compared to that cycle model fit that I made for the sun. And so this star, what do we mean by solar twin? Well, it's as nearly as we can get to the fundamental parameters, such as the effective temperature, only 46 Kelvin hotter. The surface gravity measurement is within the uncertainties equivalent to the sun. It's thought to be a little bit younger, and even the rotation period is within 2 days of the solar rotation period. So this is showing that stars that are very sun-like do behave like the sun in an absolute sense. The amplitude of this peak from 18 SCO is about 5% larger than the largest solar cycle that I had in my last 10 solar cycles. But you know, it's not out of the realm of possibility that if we observe the sun for long enough, we'll see a cycle that's 5% stronger than we've ever seen, I suppose. The shape of this of its cycle is a bit more disturbing and a bit more unlike the sun. Can the sun vary like this, basically not skipping a minimum, or is this a sign of a double period? It's a bit unclear with this much data. I think more observations are going to be needed. So next thing I want to take a look at are the differences in amplitude. So how variable are these other stars, and what does that variability depend on? And to do that, I use this as my yardstick. I use rank-based statistics. This long bar is what I call the inter-98 percentile range. It's just the difference between the 99th percentile of the whole time series and the first percentile. And then this thick black bar is the same thing on a seasonal bin basis. So there's these seasonal gaps because you can't observe the stars all year long. The sun gets in the way of them. So taking these seasonal bins and all of their inter-98 percentile ranges, and then taking the median of that, gives me an estimate of short-term variability, right? So you get basically an amplitude like this that, you know, sort of moves through the time series. I do this for all of the stars, and the center diamond there is just the median value. So plotting that same symbol with respect to rotation period, you can see that rotation plays a strong role in determining both the median value of the activity measure, which is the center diamond, but also the amplitude. The stars that rotate faster just vary by a lot more. And here I've shown you the stars whose time series you've already seen. And so in this context, the sun has a very low amplitude cycle. It's not very active. It's not very variable compared to the younger, faster rotators. Some of these things were known before, especially the relationship between activity and rotation. But what I think is new and interesting is that I found that while there's a lot of scatter between rotation and amplitude, just as much scatter as there is between rotation and the median activity level, I find nice linear relationships between the median of the activity and the amplitude of the activity up to a point. So the black points are that inter-98 percentile range for the whole 50-year time series with respect to the median value of that whole time series. And we get a line up until a point, and then it sort of breaks down. So the dotted line is the extrapolation. And those other more active stars, their amplitudes are falling below that line. So one question that remains unanswered is that because those stars have a physically different process going on that's caused this to break down, or have we just not observed them long enough? If we have 100 or 200 years, will we see variability that would put them back up on that line? Only more observations could answer a question like that. However, on the shorter time scale, so on this 1 year time scale, those are the white points. I see the linear behavior throughout the whole time series. The right panel is a different measure of amplitude with respect to the minimum seasonal median of the whole time series. And it's really just saying the same thing as the black points on the left panel. And so thinking about this, not as calcium and not as a proxy, and what it's a proxy for, it's showing that there's a linear relationship between the variations in surface flux with the median value. And it doesn't have to be that way. So if you imagine the star were efficient enough at cleaning up the surface flux, you could have the median stay at a fixed level and the amplitude go up, or vice versa. So I think this is really a constraint that can be applied to dynamo models that are exploring parameter regimes in rotation or anything that affects the activity. So next, I'd like to look at cycle quality. To do that, I had to invent a new metric. The previous metric of cycle quality was based on the false alarm probability. And it turns out that is proportional to the number of observations. So that if you measure, so here's a synthetic time series that has a 12-year signal in it, a 12-year period, and it's buried in noise, random Gaussian noise, a signal-to-noise ratio of 0.05. And using the Balyunas 95 false alarm probability, for every decade that's shown by a colored line there, I do a periodogram up to that point, and the power in the periodogram goes up, so the false alarm probability is going down, right? That makes sense. You have more data, you have more observations, the chance of this signal being wrong decreases. However, the threshold for the quality goes as the log of the number of observations. So these horizontal lines are what Balyunas 95 would have called an excellent cycle, right? And so for your first few decades, you don't have an excellent cycle, and then later on, it's excellent. And so that's not what I really want to get at when I'm thinking about cycle quality. My question is, how close is this time series to the sun's time series, right? And so what I really want and what I've come up with is something that's sensitive to the variance of the signal in question with respect to the variance of the entire time series. So it's a ratio of variances, and that's what I call normalized amplitude. In a sense, it's just turning the periodogram power, the power spectral density, into an amplitude spectral density, and normalizing it in a particular way. This is the variance of a pure sine wave. This is the variance of the whole signal. I get now that I'm independent of the number of observations. I'm in a fixed range from 0 to 1. And so since all of these observations are not in the regime where observational noise is dominating, the noise in these time series is actually the variation of the star itself on smaller timescales. It's the variability due to rotation and active region growth and decay. And so this, I believe, is a better way to measure cycle quality. My cycle quality metric, this is the amplitude spectral density for this same time series here. And you see that the peaks are more or less at the same value. And the only reason they're not exactly the same value is because I've simulated stellar sampling and put a lot of gaps in the data. But I have also made my cycle quality metric have a penalty factor for periods that haven't been observed for very long. So if you have a 20-year time series and you want to say you have a 18-year period in there, well, how can you say it's a cycle if you've only observed it once? So this sort of biases things towards cycles that have been observed many times. And I've scaled it by 100, so it's like a point system. And so this is my solar time series and its amplitude spectral density periodogram. And when I simulate stellar sampling, I see that the composite line, that's the black line, the colored lines are for the individual time series. It doesn't change very much, which is exactly what I want. I don't want to be sensitive to the number of observations in my time series when I'm saying how good the quality is. So when I do this for all the stars, I see that the solar cycle is exceptional. It's the highest quality cycle in the whole sample. And in these bins that I've made, There's only three other stars, and you know, qualitatively judging the time series, I find that a quality factor of above 40 is passively solar-like, but none of them really look like the solar cycle. And I found that kind of disturbing, and that's why I'm going to go in, into what I did next. But anyway, the bin that has the most stars is of lower quality, and those ones also have these secondary periods. I'm just going to quickly go through these just to show, give you a flavor for the best cycles in my sample. This is the solar twin that we already showed you the time series before. This is the number four best cycle. It's that double one. It's a very sun-like star, but it has this double period, so 18.7 years and 2.6 years at the peak. The number three best cycle in terms of this, you know, this relative variance is a very long cycle. So this one is at the peak is at 37 years, and it was penalized by this you know, this factor that I just discussed. But nonetheless, it still shows up as number three, because most of the variance in this signal, is due to this long period variation. The second best cycle is pretty short. The peak's at about 4.7 years. It's hard to tell if it has sun-like qualities like a fast rise and a long decay. Because of the seasonal sampling. And the number one best cycle, looks very much like the sun, actually. But it's not a very sun-like star. This is a subgiant. This is one of the subgiants. It has six solar luminosities going through it, 2.5 times the radius, and it's rotating in 40 days, much longer than the solar rotation of 25 days. So in a cruel irony, when I was looking for stars like the sun, the most sun-like output, dynamo output, it has one of the least sun-like dynamo inputs in my sample. Anyway, here's what I found. It seems that cycle quality depends on activity level, and lower activity stars have higher quality cycles. So of these 40, which I say these stars that have Q psych greater than 40, which I say are passively solar-like, some of which I just showed you, seven of those eight are on the lower part of my median activity level. So they have low amplitudes, but yet their cycle quality is higher than these fast rotating stars, and that's interesting. So I wanted to I'm gonna have to blow pretty fast. How much time do you think I have left? 5 minutes. All right. So I need more data. I don't have all the time series to do sort of the same analysis on all the stars. So I just reused the results from Balian's 95. So she observed, she published results on about 103 stars, and with that classification system that I just said is faulty because because it depends on the number of observations. But as long as all of the stars in the sample have roughly the same number of observations, then it's okay to use the cycle quality scale in a relative sense. This shows that the range of stars is increasing. So this sample includes F, G, and K type stars. This gives you a sense of how that changes. The biggest difference is in the luminosity. So this sample goes from five luminosities, four stars on the main sequence, to 0.1 solar luminosities. But in terms of mass, it's only a difference of about 50%. And here's one result. It's a Skittle plot. All of these colors here are of the characteristics of the long-term variability. So the top row are showing you the cycle classes from excellent to poor. And I've sort of shaded them green and orange to put them in roughly two different classes, which makes it easier to distinguish them. And then the non-cycling classes are shown below, the erratic variables in magenta, the long and flat in a gray tone. The long sort of secular trends in them are really a sort of a kind of flat in a lot of the cases. And what I see here is that, F stars that are low activity tend to be flat behavior. There's not a lot of high quality cycles among G stars, like the sun, which I already found in my last study. And the K-stars appear to be very good at having nice high-quality cycles when their activity is low, as you can see by this cluster of green points in the K-side of the diagram. Here's histograms showing that again. So the K-stars are not only a lot better at having a statistically significant cycle in them. So all of these three classes, F, G, and K, have about 33 stars in them. So the majority of the K-stars have some kind of statistically significant variability in there that Balanus was calling cycling. If you take more conservative, the high-quality cycles of excellent and good, most of the cycling K-stars are high-quality cycles. So, in fact, of the high-quality cycles in this whole sample, 81% of them are from K-stars. And only 9% of G-type stars are producing high-quality cycles. That includes the sun. So it appears that the solar cycle is rare in this observational context. And this brings me to Rossby number. So Rossby number is the ratio between the advection term and the Coriolis term in the momentum equation. It's thought that for the sun that it should be less than one. In order to have a fast equator, it should be around one or less than one. In the plots that I'm going to show you next, they're not on the same scale as sort of a theoretical Rossby number. So keep that in mind. So rotation is thought to be important for dynamo, not only in an absolute sense, so the rotation, the Coriolis force basically, having an influence on convective motions, but also in terms of its shear. And in the induction equation on the top, you have this shear term, and this is the internal helioseismology's differential rotation profile, which shows the regions of shear where it's thought that the omega effect is generating magnetic fields. So two different ways that rotation has a strong influence on the dynamo. And so Noyes in 84 realized that there's not a good relationship between activity and rotation directly, but when you do this semi-empirical Rossby number, you get a tighter fit. So this is activity on this axis and a semi-empirical Rossby number there. These are based on Gilman's simulations. Actually, it's on a mixing length based stellar envelope code way back in 1980, and this is still used widely today. And this is the one that I use to convert the Balanus study into Rossby number. And I see that it does the same thing here. So this is activity versus rotation period for this whole sample now this is only 84 stars. This is 83. This is the stars that have rotation periods measured in the literature. When I convert to Rossby number, they all sort of collapse under the same relationship, showing that Rossby number is important for the mean level of activity. Should I discuss this? It's very interesting. I just want to say there's a critical Rossby number that's been found recently by Van Saters in 2016, and it seems that Skumanish's spin-down law doesn't endure forever. So these points on the left-hand panel are astroseismic determined ages, so of the most, one of the most precise, or the most precise method of determining stellar age for field stars. And the black curves are a stellar evolution code that includes rotation. And so they spin down due to magnetic breaking, according to this Skumanish law, and also as they evolve, as they start expanding, they spin down as well. And what you see is that the black points, the Kepler stars, don't fall very well onto the black curve. You get much better agreement if you introduce a critical Rossby number 2.16, at which Skumanish's magnetic breaking basically stops. So there's a critical Rossby number, and it just so happens that the sun is exactly at the point where that sort of transition would be. And that's also seen in this Kepler study, where there's tens of thousands of stars with rotation periods measured. And there's this curious upper envelope where it seems like the rotation period has stopped.
there are fewer stars with slower rotation periods, and the Sun is right on the edge of that envelope. And Jen Van Saters is working on an explanation for this that's sort of based on the same sort of idea. This one I'm going to have to skip, Travis. I'm sorry. There's the idea of a critical Rossby number in simulations, which is the sense of differential rotation changing from solar-like fast equator to anti-solar slow equator and fast poles. And Featherstone's recent work has proposed that the Sun is right at that transition as well. And so here's my favorite result. This is that same Skittles plot, but now with respect to Rossby number. And what this has allowed me to do is to formulate the hypothesis. For G and K type main sequence stars, Sun-like variability, that is, a high quality cyclic variation, so that's green points, or flat activity analogous to the Maunder minimum, happens if and only if the Rossby number is greater than 1.5. And that happens to be the point where this ensemble of stars crosses what's known as the von Preston gap. The von Preston gap is seen in activity studies using hundreds of stars, and it seems to be a place where there are few stars that have activity at that level. It's not that there's zero stars, but there's fewer. And so there's not a good theoretical explanation for this, but it's thought that it might be related to physical changes in the internal in the stars, in the dynamo mechanism, that happens fast. So you spend most of the star's life either in a high activity state or in a low activity state, and very little time between it. So that's the von Preston gap, and this is where I see that the Sun shares properties with the K-type stars. So most of those green points, as I just described, are all K-type stars, and the Sun is basically sitting right on top of them in this activity Rossby number plane. I find no unquestionable counterexamples to this hypothesis in this data set. So those three green points that are high quality cycles to the left of Rossby number 1.5 in a later study by Ola 2016 that had about a decade more data for these K-type stars, classified them as complex cycles. They did a time frequency analysis, and they found a lot of higher frequency variability than the main cycle period, which is something that the Sun doesn't do. The Sun's variability is dominated by one period, the 11-year period. So those they're questionable. I'd like to take another look at those to see if there's really any reason to say, oh, these are not Sun-like, this is not Sun-like variability, whereas these are. So it's a bit of a murky issue, but I think I feel confident to put this hypothesis out there. And if anybody wants to take a few decades of observations to test this hypothesis, maybe I can be proven wrong by the time I'm ready to retire. So this is the same plot in histograms, and it's showing so the high quality cycles generally happen after Rossby number 1.5. Some of these are dual cycle stars, which I don't count as Sun-like variability if you have this strong secondary variability in there. And so that's it. Those are the conclusions. There's a linear relationship between surface flux and the variability of surface flux. Well, but why is there a break in it? The K-type stars are more likely to have high-quality cycles. Why is that? Clean monoperiodic variability, like the solar cycle, is rare in G-type stars. But I believe that when it does happen, it happens after Rossby number 1.5. And I'll just leave it there. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Ricky. I'd first like to congratulate Ricky on ascending to true scientisthood by going over time in his first colloquium. But we do have time for a few questions. Masumi.
You probably have mentioned that you might have missed. How do you define the quality of cycle?
The quality of the cycle is described here. Ba 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 ba. lots of points, slow to load. Okay. Yes. So this would be the periodogram power. This would be the number of observations. That gives you an amplitude spectral density. So instead of a power series, you get basically the amplitude. And what it really means with this normalization is it's the fraction of variability in the period in question, the variance of that signal with respect to the variance of the whole time scale. So it's a relative variance. And the sun has a very high relative variance with respect to the other stars. So most of this variability is in one period.
Jeff, I thought you had a question first.
Yeah. Something really interesting happens at smaller Rossby numbers, because that's the transition between saturation and rotational modulation of almost everything you can mention. Calcium K, Lyman alpha, X-ray, Billing factor for the magnetic field on the star, all kinds of things, change their behavior not at 1.5 for Rossby number, but about 0.1 or 0.2. So I find it very interesting that there's now two numbers in which the behavior of a star changes. One number corresponding to a Rossby number and smaller Rossby numbers, faster rotation, corresponding to saturation, and the other, sun-like, much down on the rotational modulation curve where every variable is varying with a Rossby number. So I found it very interesting. Two numbers.
Right. I would say three. Because I set 1.5 as the onset of sun-like variability, and then there's Van Sater's 2.16, where the rotational breaking seems to stop.
Yep. Okay.
Paul.
So, and while you're on this slide of the quality, it also seems that the shorter your period of observations, the more you underestimate the rotation rate. So is there a, if I'm understanding these plots correctly, is there a, do you have a cutoff there where you say I need to be observing for at least X number of periods before I can be confident of really pulling out?
No, I don't have a cutoff. Most of my series, time series, are of the order of 40 years or longer, so they tend to be of the same length anyway. I'm not sure what you meant by rotation period. This is to measure the cycle period.
That's what I mean, not rotation period, cycle. Yeah, because look, if you look at the, where you've cut that off after like one solar cycle, you estimate a period of, a cycle of 9 years maybe, something like that, instead of.
I see what you're saying. Yeah, so as you know, the uncertainty in the period is related to how much data you have. It is related to that fraction. So you have these broader peaks. You're more uncertain about where the top of that peak is, for one thing. The other thing that skews this is the seasonal gaps and just the random removal of data that I've done in this experiment to simulate stellar sampling. But yeah, my cycle quality metric, this is the penalty factor. And so, you know, if you get, in the best case, if you tried to claim a period that is longer than the number of observations, this thing could actually go negative. I don't do anything like that. But it does punish shorter time series anyway. Does that answer your question? Sorry.
First, a biographical remark. The term flocculi goes back to Secchi, I think. Mm-hmm. Secondly, this is an incredibly rich piece of work and shows that data mining can really be very insightful. So I congratulate you to your work. Now, you did point out that the signal that you are hinging upon to characterize the magnetic cycle is, of course, breaks down if you have very strong fields, like over a sunspot. If you keep in mind that in all these stars, we do not see anything resolved, and fantasize for a minute that there would be a star that has only two states. One is sort of quiet sun, and the other one is, boom, there is a strong field. You would have no signal, or close to no signal. So in other words, we have to keep in mind that there could be in some sort of more realistic cycle, could be phases where we track the activity through this limited indicator worse than at other times. And that could lead to a false signal.
Right. Yeah, that's true. We can't see the surfaces, and there are many ways that that you could be fooled in that sense. But I suppose as long as there is surface convection that is chewing away at these strong magnetic fields and producing regions of not as strong magnetic fields, then you would still have a proportionality there.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not in a position to make the case on any of these examples. I'm just saying we have to have this awareness.
Yeah.
And any means to get to resolving the surface distribution, I'm thinking, of course, of occultations of some kind, would probably be helpful.
I proposed a few weeks ago observations of active nearby sunlight stars with the Shara interferometer, which would resolve the surfaces to a very low resolution. But nonetheless, it would be the first imaging of one of these stars. That's right. All comes back to Hale and Mount Wilson.
But could you see anything in activity-related bands? I mean, Chara's
no. I don't think it'll be that good. Yeah, you'll be lucky to get 3 pixels across.
But if you have a planet going ahead of a star, then you have a little bit of a probe.
Okay, I'm going to close the discussion there. Let's thank Ricky again.